Welcome to BBC What's New. Now, if you're like me and Deb, you will love sharing stories with your friends and family.
True that, and we all share stories for different reasons. Could be about a celebrity we like, something funny or quirky, or simply something interesting. But the question is, before pressing send, do we ever stop to think, is this real?
You're right, good point. But some of the stories we read online or on social media feeds may appear to be telling the truth, but sometimes they're not, they're fake.
So how do you tell the difference? I've been back to my old school in Nairobi in Kenya to talk to students about what to look out for.
Crisp, clean, fresh. When the first news of the day drops and people can't wait to catch up with what's happening in Nairobi and beyond. Even though people still read newspapers to get the day's headlines, mobile phones and social media is king. YouTube, Facebook and WhatsApp are the most popular social media platforms in Kenya. Around 3 million people in the country use YouTube every month. Facebook has more than 8 million users, while WhatsApp is the most popular with 12 million users. And this is the platform that is most widely used to share stories.
My old primary school. I've been talking to students to find out about how social media has changed the way we find out about the world around us and about what's real and what's fake. So we're gonna play a game and I'm gonna show you a series of stories, and what I want you to do with your red card, I'll ask you, if you believe it is fake, put up your red card, okay? Who knows Soleil Dam? Okay? So there's a problem at Soleil Dam and they ordered an investigation, okay? And now is the picture that went with it. How many think this is false?
I think it's false because at the time of the incident, there are people who are living under the dam. But in the picture, yes, it doesn't look like.
So actually, the story might be true, but the picture is fake. This is a dam in China. So you're right. So those who put up the red cards, well done. That's one form of false information or fake news. The headline might be real, but the picture is fake, okay? So you can't just put any picture with a story. Still have energy to play some more? Let's go. In Nairobi, while it was flooding, this happened. Oh, your cards went up very quickly, eh? So somebody tell me why.
At the back there, you can see the water not very high. Yes. But here, these people are swimming the butterfly stroke, and you need a lot of space to move your hands and see.
The water looks too clean.
The water looks a bit too clean at the front. When it rains in Nairobi, the water is muddy, yeah? Okay, well done, guys. You nailed that one. That was absolutely fake.
Sometimes real news looks like fake news. There's a lot of pictures that look so convincing that you may think it's real, but to a shot, it's fake.
Well done. Oh, it was so great to visit my old school. I was there for the BBC's Beyond Fake News project, and part of that is about helping young people understand what fake news is. Here at the BBC, we have our own definition. When people are trying to make money by getting you to click on something, or if they publish it for political reasons, that's fake news. Have a look at this.
Fake news. Have you heard about it? It's in the news a lot lately, but what is it? Well, fake news is when people make up stories and present them as facts. The reason people are talking about it is because it's causing major problems around the world. Fake news is making people believe things that are not true. Remember, the facts are real, stories can be made up. Fake news has been around for ages. Ever since we started to tell stories and print them for people to read, things have been made up. In the old days, it was easy to spot fake news because it cost a lot of money to make it believable. But the internet and cell phones have changed things. Nowadays, anyone could make up a website that has fake news and millions could read it. This is why fake news is bad. Let's look at John. So, John is a politician and he wants your vote. But John has enemies. those enemies want John to lose the vote. So John's enemies make up a website that's full of lies. People will see the fake website and decide John is corrupt, and then they won't vote for him. This is bad, because people will have decided their vote based on a lie. During the last election in America, a lot of people invented fake news, and some say it caused major problems. So, here's how you spot it. First, question it. Does this seem real? Do the facts look correct to you? Is the writing full of spelling mistakes and grammatical errors? And does it also have weird photos? If any of these are evident, the chances are you may be looking at fake news. The best thing to do is just ignore it. Or if you can, report it to an adult. You might also want to warn your friends. This story is fake news.
Here are some other stories making headlines this week.
Yes, first up, we're starting in California, on the west coast of the United States, where fierce wildfires have been burning for several days.
Around 250,000 people have been forced to evacuate as homes and buildings have been destroyed and dozens have died.
The community has praised the firefighting teams who are working very hard to contain the blaze. Next, over in Morocco, students have been protesting against government decisions to keep its clocks at summertime all year round.
Yes. Students now have to get up before the sun rises to go to school. People are angry about the change and they've been protesting.
And finally, 40-year-old footballing legend Didier Drogba could be retiring after 20 years.
He's earned a reputation as one of the Premier League's all-time top scorers, winning African Footballer of the Year twice.
He said last month that this would be his final season, although he's keeping his fans guessing with cryptic messages online. So watch this space. This week's big interview is with the star of African photography. Omar Diop's pictures are in huge demand around the world, and you can see why.
Mm-hmm. By mixing historical and modern elements in his photos, Omar wants to revive African history, taking us on a journey back in time. Renee went to meet him.
Omar Victor Diop was born in Senegal, the youngest of six children. He's a self-taught photographer who specializes in self-portraits, photographing himself as a forgotten historical figures of Africa. He says he's able to revisit the history and the heritage of African and Afro descent around the world.
Cette idée de me photographier moi-même, elle est venue quand j'ai découvert ces histoires de...
This idea of photographing myself came to me when I discovered the stories of these people that everyone had forgotten and who lived extraordinary lives through reading and doing research. For example, many years ago, these people were sent to America and Europe as soldiers or slaves or prisoners. They were very important because they became great scientists, musicians and politicians. It's a way for me to remember them through my work.
Through photography, Omar wants to bring people's attention to these historical figures. For example, these pictures recreate the history of the Senegalese tirailleurs of the camp of Tairoi. These soldiers, who came from the old French territories of sub-Saharan Africa, fought in the French army during the First and the Second World War. When they returned home, they protested at not being paid their wages and became known for demanding their rights.
What was it important for you to revisit the African struggle then?
When I was at school or when I was growing up, I was never shown examples of Africans of excellence and who were exceptional. So I believed that there weren't any, but in fact, there were many. I don't want others to have the same problem. For example, I want young people to see that you can be African and exceptional.
What kind of advice would you give to a young person who's watching us at the moment who want to basically do exactly the same kind of art that you do?
Le conseil que je donne à
The advice that I would give to all the youngsters who want to get into photography is to start now. You also don't need to wait to have a professional camera, because now even with a phone you can create beautiful images. And when you do something like that, you need to show it and not keep it to yourself.
Il faut le montrer, il faut pas le garder pour soi.
Coming up on What's New.
What's the magical formula to go from go-karting to the Grand Prix? Last week, there was a big election in the United States, and it dominated the headlines in newspapers and TVs all over the world.
These elections are called midterms because they're held every 4 years in between the presidential elections.
Sounds confusing, yeah? Well, to explain how they work and what happened this time round, here's Kesha.
Every 4 years, people in the US vote in the presidential elections. But the US government, which is also known as Congress, is made up of more than just the president. It's actually split into two key groups known as the Senate and the House of Representatives. Now, the majority of these politicians are voted for in elections called the midterms because they happen right in the middle of the US president's term in office. These elections are important because any policies that the president wants to introduce has to be approved by both the House and the Senate. So if most of the politicians from both groups are in the same party as the president, then that's easy. But if the opposition party has the majority in either side of Congress, then they can vote against the president's plans. So what happened this time? Well, Donald Trump's Republican Party lost control of the House of Representatives to the Democratic Party, and now they're hoping to block some of his policies, like his plan to build a wall at the US-Mexico border, for example.
We will build the wall 100%.
But even with that, Donald Trump considers the results a success because his Republican Party were able to hold on to power in the Senate and also increase the number of seats that they had there.
Thanks, Kesha. So now we know how the system works. Why don't we find out about a woman who was making the headlines on the night? Ilhan Omar arrived in the US aged 14 as a refugee from Somalia. She spent some of her childhood in a refugee camp, but now she's a US congresswoman. Let's find out more.
This woman loves breaking down barriers and smashing records.
People are choosing hope over fear and unity over division. And it's a really exciting opportunity.
She is 37-year-old Ilhan Omar, a Somali-American who's gone from one of the world's biggest refugee camps to the US Congress. She was elected with nearly 80% of the vote in Minnesota, which has the highest concentration of Somali immigrants in the country. Her election is especially huge news because most Somali citizens are still banned from even traveling to America. President Trump says it's to keep the country safe, but many people say it's discriminatory. No
fear! Minnesota, it's a cold state, but the people have warm hearts, and we don't just welcome immigrants, but we send them to Washington.
And not only is she the first Somali American to be voted into Congress, she's also one of only two Muslim women elected, and she'll be the first congresswoman to wear a headscarf. So how has her election gone down with people in Somalia?
I'm very pleased with the victory of that Somali Muslim woman who got 80% in the US midterm elections. And that victory is for all Somalis. It shows that Somali women can achieve tremendous success.
I couldn't sit on the sidelines and not be part of a group of people who were insisting on a set of values that got us closer to the America we know we can have and the America we know we deserve.
Mambo VP!
Oh, Ben, you speak Swahili now.
Yeah. Well, not really, but it would be very useful because Swahili is the most widely spoken African language with over 90 million speakers in Africa alone.
Yes, Swahili has official language status in Tanzania and Kenya, but it's also spoken in Uganda, the Democratic Republic of Congo, Rwanda, Burundi, and the Comoro Islands.
Now, on the coastal strip of Kenya, we find Lamu. It's home to Swahili speakers and attracts thousands of tourists every year because of its history and beauty.
And today, we're taking you there.
I am so excited to finally be in Lamu, an island that is known for its amazing Swahili culture. I really enjoyed the boat ride from the airport, and I can't wait to just go into the town and, you know, just have the amazing food, go to the museum, and just learn all about this culture. So hey, let's take a look at it.
Lamu Island is located in the northern coast of Kenya and is considered a UNESCO heritage because of preserving the Swahili culture for many decades.
So I'm still discovering Lamu and of course the beautiful Swahili culture, and I've just been told that around the corner there's a nice shop where I can go get a kanga. So a kanga is a lady's Swahili dress, and I cannot wait to be decked and become a full Swahili lady. So hey, let's go check it out. I'm about to go get dressed. So I've just met Kautar, who is a resident here in Lamu.
Yeah.
And she's gonna help me to tie this because I really don't know how to do it. And she's gonna make me a full Swahili lady.
Oh, good, yes, and I'll be glad that I'm increasing a full Swahili lady.
I'm a full Swahili lady. Thanks to Kautar. Oh my god. So this is called Kubobwe, and she saw it when there are two. It's called Lesombili. I'm officially Swahili woman by the name Hairun, but I had to take off the lessons and I've come all the way to Shela village, which is also an amazing small village in Lamu Island, and I'm just about to meet Hadija, who does some amazing Swahili tattoo work called Hina. Can't wait to see how that is going to turn out.
Application on women is another symbol for beauty in the Swahili culture and is mostly done during weddings and many different cultural celebrations. Hina by itself is a black dye and is usually mixed with water, lemon juice, or strong tea into a paste that can be applied. The hina is then applied to the skin using a stick or a plastic. The hina is then left to dry.
This is so beautiful. Hadija has fully transformed my hand. I don't know, she told me I can stay with this for 2 weeks. So hey, I think I'm still going to be having this Swahili culture for quite some time. Thank you, Hadija.
Centuries. The narrow, winding streets accommodate only pedestrian or donkey traffic. The architecture and the urban structure of Lamu graphically demonstrates the cultural influences that have come together there over several hundred years from Europe, Arabia, and India, utilizing traditional Swahili techniques to produce a distinct culture. Decided to visit Lamu's silver store, where Swahili ladies come to bear their jewelry, and couldn't leave without grabbing myself some ancient piece made of porcelain and silver.
And of course, I cannot leave Lamu without sampling their amazing Swahili dishes.
To experience Swahili food is to taste the history of East Coast of Africa. The Arabic and Persian influence is very much present in the Swahili cuisine. Most of the cooking is rich in spices and the use of coconut. Popular Swahili dishes include fish from the sea, biryani, vitumbua, kaimati, and mshikaki. I hope you got to learn something and enjoyed the amazing journey with me of discovering the Swahili culture in Lamu.
Oh, that's nice. Now, it's considered the most expensive sport in the world. So how do racing drivers break into the world of Formula One? Well, according to one promising teenager from Senegal, the trick is to start small and understand how much you need to learn. Let's meet him.
J'aime la vitesse.
I love speed. I love driving fast.
Quand je suis sur la piste,
when I'm on the track, I don't think about anything. I just focus on the track and just on the engine, which runs non-stop. Hi, my name is Mamadou, aka Momo. I'm 17 years old. I'm a go-karting driver. When we make checks like these, the driver has to check that his kart is okay, and that's what makes a good driver. Someone who has a strong connection with his vehicle. 3 or 4 years ago, I had a problem with the engine during a race. So I could not carry on driving because the engine was not working. It's a sport which relies on mechanics, so you can have a technical problem anytime. It is possible to find a center for Formula 4, but the sport itself is expensive, so you need a sponsor who can financially help you.
Tout le projet, en échange d'une contrepartie. Je pense qu'il est.
It's better to train in Senegal because the location is more challenging. For example, the weather, the temperature, and with all these challenges, you can be a better driver. It's like going to school. You have lots of things to learn. The driver cannot know everything, as there are always unexpected surprises. Even if you know how to drive, there is always something new to learn. My dream is to become a Formula One driver, but at the beginning, I would like to start as a Formula 4 driver. It takes years and years to go up a level each time. I do find the sport difficult, but it makes me happy.
Inspiring. That's all from us for now, but don't forget to check out our YouTube page. You can find more from the What's New team.
Yes, just go to youtube.com/BBC What's New and make sure you hit that subscribe button to keep up to date with all of our latest interviews and stories.
See you next week.
Bye.